Good morning, Bentry. It's great to see you. Do you have your Bible? I hope so. Please turn to 1 John chapter 5. 1 John's way near the back of your Bible, for those of you that are still learning where things are. 1 John chapter 5, verse 11. Let's pray before we dive in together, shall we? Oh Lord, it is so good to be together. It is so good to sing and to greet one another with warmth and love. It is so good to be in a place where we know we belong. It is good. It is so good to open the Bible and to know that we're about to read some words that have been an encouragement to our brothers and sisters in Christ for 2,000 years. Lord Jesus, let them be an encouragement to us today, I pray. By your Spirit, speak through me. Give us ears to hear. Let our hearts be pliable, teachable, moldable. I give this time to you, and I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, when I was in college, I roomed with a guy named Jim. My freshman year, I had one roommate, and then Jim and I moved into an apartment for our sophomore year, and then we roomed together junior and senior year. So 3 years together, you know, sharing a bedroom, sharing meals. He had a motorcycle, and I would sit on the back. He said I was like a sail on the back of his motorcycle. Just the wind would pick me up, and he had these big, huge speakers on his motorcycle, and he was an opera singer, and he would drive down the streets of Minneapolis, St. Paul with the opera blaring, singing at the top of his lungs with me holding on. We just had a great time. If Jimbo were to decide to commission someone to write a biography of his 3 years in college, he would have to choose me to write it. No one had a more intimate perspective of his life those 3 years. No one saw the ins and the outs, the highs and the lows. No one experienced it like me because I was his roommate. I was his buddy. Wouldn't it be cool if we could find Jesus' roommate and ask him to write a biography of the 3 years that they spent together? Oh, wait, we have that. John was Jesus' roommate, if you will. For 3 years, they shared life together. Now, I know there were other guys around too, and they had an intimate connection with Jesus, but John in his gospel, which by the way is his biography of those 3 years, in his gospel, he calls himself the disciple that Jesus loved. Surely he loved all of them, but there was something really close. They were like best friends. They were roomies. And after it was all said and done, John sat down and he wrote the story of those 3 years. So John's gospel in your Bible is as intimate a perspective of the life of Jesus that you're going to find. But that's not the only book that John wrote. He also wrote the book of Revelation, which is at the end of your Bible. He wrote this when he was a very old guy on the island of Patmos. He was in exile there. And around that same time, 80 to 85 AD, he wrote some letters. And these letters, two of them went to individuals, but one of them went to the church as a whole. And these letters were precious to the church because John, most people believe, was the last surviving disciple at this time. The rest had all passed away. And he was still going strong in his old age. And he was a pillar of the church, and everyone listened to him when he spoke. He was E.F. Hutton, you know. When he spoke, people listened. And so this letter that we're about to start looking at today, 1 John, was precious, precious, precious to the early church. And some of you may be saying, well, that's cool and all, but that was 2,000 years ago. The church is very different now. The world's very different now. Why would I want to study 1 John? Why should I care? What's the point? Well, I'm so glad you asked that question because there's really, really good reasons. In fact, John gives us the reasons right in the text. I found myself thinking about unspoken struggles that people have. Some of these unspoken struggles, five of them that I'm going to point out, are addressed in 1 John. Let's see if you can relate, if you've thought any of these things. The first unspoken struggle is that you wonder, every once in a while, you wonder if you're actually saved or not. You struggle with assurance of salvation. You do something, and after you do it, you think, man, maybe I'm not a Christian. If I was a Christian, I wouldn't have done that. You think something, you say something. There's something you just can't get on top of. Whatever it happens to be, it causes you to wonder, just wonder if you're actually saved or not. In 1 John chapter 5, verse 13, John says these things. I write these things to you. Okay, he's about to tell us why he's writing this letter. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God. So right now he's speaking to believers, so that you may know that you have eternal life. To believers, he wants them to know. The word know appears 30 times in 1 John. It's a theme all the way through. He wants you to know. He doesn't want you to hope. He doesn't want you to think. He wants you to know that you stand secure in Christ. A second unspoken struggle that people have is that they think that they may be susceptible to false teaching. And there's a good reason for this. It's because they are susceptible to false teaching. We find ourselves listening to someone, and after a while, someone, one of our dear friends says, whoa, be careful, listen to this, this is off. And it went like right over your head, you didn't catch it. There was a false teaching that was infiltrating the church at the time that John wrote. We know it now as Gnosticism. Probably wasn't called that at this point. In fact, we don't know that much about Gnosticism from John's day because the a description of it was really written a couple centuries later by theologians. But we know that Gnosticism was alive and well in the church, was creeping into the church. In 1 John chapter 2, verse 19, John says, they went out from us, but they did not really belong to us. For if they had belonged to us, they would have remained with us. But their going showed that none of them belonged to us. So apparently some folks had walked away from the church. They'd left the church and they started a church down the street. But it wasn't really a church. It was a group of Gnostic thinkers. And it was a heresy. And their thinking was really influencing the people in the church. They were wondering, are we right or are we wrong? Are they right or are we wrong? And they were really unnerved. Gnosticism can be defined with this statement. The few, the proud, the knowledgeable. That's how they would describe themselves. The few and the proud, because the whole concept of Gnosticism was an intellectual elitism, that you were saved by mentally ascending to a certain plateau, and only a very few people are able to get there. The rest of the commoners, they can't make it. It was an elitist intellectualism, the few and the proud and the knowledgeable, the knowing ones. Gnosticism comes from the Greek word gnosis, which means to know. These people knew certain things that other people didn't know. Their theology, their doctrine, centered around the fact that there were two gods, they said, a good God and an evil God. The evil God was actually the creative God, the one who created the universe and the earth. So anything that is created, they considered evil. So anything physical was evil. Their real goodness happens in the spiritual realm. It was a dualism between the spiritual world and the physical world. There's a lot of problems with this. One obvious problem is that they had a really hard time with the incarnation. They had a hard time with God himself becoming flesh because, well, flesh is evil. Spirit is good, so they had all these explanations for who Jesus was that wasn't the Son of God in the flesh. This also led to the fact that they had a hard time with the crucifixion, which makes sense, and thus the resurrection. So incarnation, crucifixion, resurrection, these are not peripheral issues, friends. This is like the core of our faith, right? And they whittled away at it because they saw matter and the physical world as evil and the spiritual world as where things were. The themes of Gnosticism still survive in our modern day. They show up periodically. The Jewish tradition of Kabbalah has a lot of Gnostic thought in it. Scientology, a lot of people outside Scientology don't know a whole lot about the inner workings of it, but if you've come out of Scientology, you know that one of the main concepts is that everyone's asleep and they need to be awakened intellectually. And the reason they were put into this slumber is because of MEST, matter, energy, space, and time. It's another dualism thing, that all that stuff is evil and you got to rise above it. It's Gnosticism at its core. The therapist Carl Gustav Jung was deeply influenced by Gnostic writers. And he was very influential in the whole therapeutic and psychological world in which we find ourselves now. Do you remember The Da Vinci Code by Daniel Brown? Tons of Gnostic thoughts in that book. So it pops up every once in a while. Most of us, modern day believers, are not going to fall for Gnosticism. But Gnosticism isn't the only false teaching out there. False teaching pops up all the time. And we have to be able to recognize it. We can't be susceptible to it. When my dad was a young man, he was a bank examiner. I've told you this before. And he had to be able to figure out what were counterfeit bills and what were authentic bills. And the way they trained him was not to show him a bunch of counterfeit bills so he could learn the patterns, because counterfeiters are always coming up with new ones. The way they trained him was to study the authentic bills. And if he knew them well enough, then an inauthentic one would be obvious when he glanced at it. This is how we protect ourselves from false teaching. We figure out the authentic faith, the truth. And then when something false comes our way, we're like, whoa, that's out of bounds. I'm not going anywhere near that. We're able to recognize it. If you struggle recognizing false teaching, 1 John is going to help you, as John attacks Gnosticism at its core by teaching us the essence of our faith. A third unspoken struggle is that some of us are having a hard time loving people, or maybe certain people, or maybe that one person. We know we're supposed to love. We want to love. But we're not that good at it. We're struggling. Shortly before Jesus went to the cross, he had a conversation with his disciples. And in that conversation, he said to them, "A new command I give to you, love one another as I have loved you." But that command was kind of lost on the disciples. The reason it was kind of lost is because what Jesus said right before that. What he said right before that is, hey, I'm leaving, and where I'm going, you can't come to. By the way, a new command I give to you, to love one another as I have loved you. He takes a breath and Peter jumps in, where are you going? It's like Jesus didn't even hear the love part. He just heard the I'm leaving part. Jesus addresses the where I'm going and never circles back around to the new commandment I give to you. But John, who was sitting there that day, he heard it. He heard it, and he knew that love was the mark of the church. He knew that love was a mark of true, authentic believers. And so no less than 54 times, John in these five short chapters addresses love. I mean, it's a major theme in this book. If you are struggling to love, this book is going to help you as the Spirit opens it up to you. In 1 John 4:7, he says, "Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God." Love comes from God. A fourth unspoken struggle. You hear all the time about having an intimate relationship with Jesus, but it just doesn't seem to work for you that way. You long for it. You wonder what it might be like. But you personally, it never feels that way. God feels distant to you. It feels a little cold. It doesn't feel warm and intimate. In 1 John 1:3, John says, "We proclaim to you what we have seen and heard, so that you also may have fellowship with us. And our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ." He comes right out of the chute and starts talking about intimacy with the Father and intimacy with the Son. Fellowship, koinonia, oneness. If you struggle with intimacy, this book is for you. Finally, you've lost your joy, or you never had it. You long for joy. Well, in 1 John 1:4, John says, "We write this to make our joy complete." There's what's called a textual variant on the word "our," which means there are some early manuscripts that had the word "your" there instead of "our." So we're not quite sure what the original one was, but really it doesn't matter that much, because when we are one as a family, my joy is your joy is my joy. What he's saying here is that if you can grasp the essence, if you can get this, joy will creep into your joy-starved heart and take up residence there. So why should we read and study 1 John? Because a lot of stuff we're dealing with, he addresses in a powerful and supernatural way. Okay, so all that talking I just did, that's not my sermon. That doesn't even count. That's the introduction of the whole series. We're starting the sermon now, okay? Okay, so please open your Bibles to John chapter 1, verse 1. John chapter 1, verse 1. Before I start this sermon, there's an elephant in the room we need to talk about. There's this football game today. Am I right? There's a guy back there in a Tony Romo jersey. He's hoping for Tony to show up today. I kind of am too at some point during the game. Okay, so many of you know I'm a Packer fan, but we love each other anyway, right? And today the Cowboys are playing the Packers. Big game, right? Win or go home. A little nervous? I'm a little nervous. It's kind of exciting, isn't it? If you've been listening to sports radio all week, you've been hearing the pundits talking about how this game's gonna go. There's all these factors, right? There's 106 world-class athletes that are gonna get strapped up and ready to go. They have been prepared. They are in the most fit shape you could possibly imagine. They've been trained. They've been ready. They know the game plan. They're gonna march out there, and it's gonna be the clash of the Titans. It's gonna be amazing. And there's all these factors that are gonna lead to one team winning or the other. Is it the coaching? Is it the offense, the defense? Is it the special teams? Is it the kicker? But if you listen all week long, you'll hear the experts saying things like this. You know what? It all boils down to fill in the blank. They zero down on one specific thing, and that's going to be the key factor in the game. It all boils down to, I think the one that makes the most sense to me is it all boils down to, can the Cowboys run the ball effectively to keep Aaron Rodgers off the field? That's what it comes down to. And you say yes. Of course you do, because you know exactly what's gonna happen, right? Okay, the fact is, it all boils down to something. It's gonna come down to something, one thing. It's an interesting phrase, isn't it? It all boils down to. It originally comes from putting something on the burner, something liquid, and burning it off so that you get down to the essence of the liquid, of the fluid that you have there. It all boils down to the essence. What John is going to do for us in 1 John is he's going to boil everything down to the essence. His thesis would be, if you live in the essence, if you understand it, if you dwell there, everything else takes care of itself. So what is the essence of Christianity? What is it? Some would have you think that it's the way we vote. Right? We are being labeled now by the way we vote in presidential elections. But I'm gonna tell you, the first thing that evaporates when we turn the heat up is our voting records. It has nothing to do with the essence of Christianity. Some would say, you know what? It's the rituals. It's the things we do. It's the worship rituals. If we grew up in the Catholic background, it was going to mass. It was going to confession. If we grew up in the Baptist circles or Bible churches, evangelical churches, it wasn't necessarily mass. We did the Lord's Supper. We didn't go to confession. We have accountability groups. But we all have our rituals. If you turn up the heat a little bit, the rituals evaporate quite quickly. Is it the family traditions? I don't know about you, but I've had so many conversations with people over the years when I've asked them their spiritual journey, and they've said something like this. You know what? When I was young, every time the door was open, I was there. And I have no idea why I did that in the Southern accent. But have you ever heard that phrase? Every time the door was open, I was there. That's someone who grew up going to church on Sunday morning and Sunday night and Wednesday night and youth group and everything in between, right? And the essence of Christianity for us growing up was attendance. If you went, you were a Christian. Turn the heat up a little bit. It's gone. It's not the essence. Is it ethics? Is it aligning our behavior with certain cultural norms? I don't smoke, drink, or chew, or go with girls that do. Remember that one? That's one that some of us grew up with. We come up with our little rules and our don't do's, and the essence of Christianity for many of us is don't do. When my dad was growing up, he had a long list of don't do's in his little congregation that he was a part of. He was not allowed to play cards. He was not allowed to do sports on Sunday. Not allowed. In fact, as he started to learn more and more about the essence of Christianity, he realized, wait a minute, I can play cards. And so he asked his daughter, my sister, to teach him. I was there, it was hilarious. She takes out the cards and she goes, he's like, where did you learn to do that? He was freaking out, right? She had to teach him what the suits were and how it all worked. And he had no idea because it was on the don't do list. And you know what? When you turn the heat up a little bit, you know what? You know what? It just evaporates. The don't do list just evaporates. It's not the essence of Christianity. If it's not all those things, what is it? It's a really crucial question because if you can figure out the essence, then you can figure out if you're really saved or not. You'll no longer be susceptible to false teaching because you know the authentic deal. Love will start to emanate from you. You'll experience intimacy. Joy will come back. It's really important that you know what the essence is. In 1 John chapter 5, verse 11, John tells us the essence. It's really pretty simple. And this is the testimony, he says. God has given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. In case you missed it, verse 12. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life, period. The essence. The essence is life. But not just any life. The life of the Son of God. Let me expand the essence this way. Write this down. We're going to come back to it over and over and over again in our series. Here's the essence of the Christian life. The essence is the joy of sharing in the eternal life of Christ together. The joy of sharing in the eternal life of Christ together. I got that from the text. Let's read it together. Would you please stand with me as I read the first four verses of 1 John? 1 John 1, 1 through 4. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked at and our hands have touched, this we proclaim concerning the word of life. The life appeared. We have seen it and we testify to it. And we proclaim to you the eternal life, which was with the Father and has appeared to us. We proclaim to you what we have seen and heard, so that you also may have fellowship with us. And our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. We write this to make our joy, your joy, complete. This is the reading of God's word. Thanks be to God. Please have a seat. Okay, so the joy of sharing in the eternal life of Christ together. Let's work at that from the back to the beginning. Let's talk first of all about the joy. It says in verse 4, we write this to make our and your joy complete. The word complete means filled to the full, filled to the brim, overflowing. We write this so that your life will be characterized by joy just oozing out of you. Martin Lloyd-Jones defines joy this way in commenting on this text, and I quote, joy is a state of complete satisfaction. I love that definition of joy. A state of complete satisfaction. He goes on, there is only one thing that can truly give joy, and that is a contemplation of the Lord Jesus Christ. He satisfies my mind. He satisfies my emotions. He satisfies every desire. Joy, in other words, is the response and the reaction of the soul to a knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ, end quote. That's what true joy is. And when that kind of joy is a state that we live in, a complete satisfaction, then even though our world starts to fall apart, we still find ourselves in joy, in complete satisfaction. The election doesn't go the way we hoped. Satisfaction remains. I get downsized at work. Satisfaction remains. We lose everything, satisfaction remains. Your boyfriend dumps you, satisfaction remains. This type of joy stays. And John has written this letter so you can experience that type of complete satisfaction all the time. It's quite a goal, isn't it? It's a beautiful thought. So this joy comes from sharing in something. Essence is the joy of sharing in the eternal life of Christ together. Look at verse 3. We proclaim to you what we have seen and heard, so that you also may have fellowship with us. And our fellowship, okay, let's start marking up our Bibles. Circle fellowship. It's the word koinonia. It's a famous Greek word. It means to share in. And our sharing in, our koinonia is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. The essence of the Christian life is an experience that hasn't changed since the apostles experienced it. Let me say that again. The experience that he is calling you into is something that John himself experienced. He says, we want you to experience the same fellowship that we have. A lot of times we'll think, you know what? If only I could have been back there in those days. If I could have been a disciple walking around with Jesus, then my Christian life would really be rich. And what John is saying is his. I didn't need to experience that. You can experience the exact same thing I am experiencing. Because it's the essence for every single believer. Gnostics said only a few people get to this place. True Christianity says, oh, there's this simple, beautiful place that anyone who is willing and wants it can have. All of us can share in the Father. All of us can share in his Son, Jesus Christ. Koinonia means to share, to participate in. It's a word of intimacy. It means communion. It means partaking of, union with, intimacy. Peter tells us in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 4, that when we put our trust in Jesus Christ, something remarkable happens. We are made new, given a new spirit, and we become, listen, partakers of the divine nature. Let me say that again. Listen, partakers of the divine nature. Same word, koinonia, of this divine nature. We share in God. He enters us. We become one with him. This, my friends, is the essence of Christianity. It is what distinguishes Christianity from everything else. It is koinonia with the Father through the Son. For I was crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. Paul taught this all the time. So Libby and I go to yoga together. Yes, we go to yoga together. One of the reasons I feel comfortable going to yoga together is because we are not easily deceived. And you can be deceived if you're not careful in some of these places. And our little yoga place that we go to, our yoga teacher, who's a phenomenal yoga teacher, does a little devotional each time. And Libby has pointed out to me how so close she is in her devotionals. Let me give you an example. This last Friday, her devotional went like this. We're talking about fullness. And what most of you do is you live from a place of lack. You have a hole in you. She literally said this. You have a hole in you, and you're trying to fill it with things and with stuff and with people and experiences, but what you don't know is it's a bottomless hole. And the more stuff you throw in there, it doesn't matter. You're never going to be satisfied. And I'm sitting there thinking, preach it, sister. I preached that exact thing, have I not? And then she went on. What you need to do is you need to live from a place of abundance. If you live from a place of abundance, then you're overflowing. And I'm like, she's nailing it. And then she stopped. That was it. Of course, thinking people would just kind of raise their hands. Excuse me, that abundance thing, where's that? Where do I get that from? I mean, it sounds awesome. I would love to live from a place of abundance, but what's missing in her devotional? The source is missing in the devotional, the source of life, the source of abundance. Yes, by all means, live from a place of abundance. And by the way, his name is Jesus. That's the place of abundance. That's life. The difference between you and me, I'm sorry, there's not much difference between you and me. The difference between us and others who don't know him is simply life. It's the difference. It's the source. It's the essence of Christianity. The essence, in case you've forgotten, is the joy of sharing in the eternal life of Christ together. It goes on to say here that what we are sharing in is eternal life. Look at verse 1. We're going to finally get to the beginning of the text. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, the disciples and the apostles heard the teaching of Jesus, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked at, and our hands have touched. Boy, he's going out of his way here to point out what? That Jesus was physically present with them. Why is he going out of his way to do that? Well, remember, Gnosticism said that matter and the physical world is evil, so they couldn't imagine the Son of God becoming flesh. He is combating Gnosticism in the very first verse. No, he was here. He was flesh. He was fully man and fully God, Orthodox Christian doctrine. This we proclaim. Concerning what? Concerning the word of life. Would you please put a box around word of life there? Word of life. Now, some of you have read your Bible, most of you have, and you've read the Gospel of John, and you know that in the Gospel of John, John has a nickname for Jesus. What is it? The Word, Logos. In the prologue, in the beginning of the Gospel of John, he starts with these words. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The Word is the Son of God. And so those of you reading 1 John here think, okay, he used word as a nickname for Jesus in the gospel, so he's probably doing the same thing here. And so here what he's talking about is that Jesus is going to bring life to people, but that's not what he means. The reason I know it's not what he means is because in this little phrase, life is his nickname for Jesus, not word. You say, how do you know that, Pete? Well, look at the very next verse. Look at the beginning of verse 2. The life appeared. It doesn't say the word appeared. It says the life appeared. So the word in word of life is actually the proclamation or the gospel or the good news of life. Jesus is life. And this life appeared. He made his entrance into humanity. James Montgomery Boyce says this of this verse, and I quote, "It is Jesus and not a system of thought who is essential core of Christian proclamation. The Gnostics had a system, just as many professional religionists have a system today, but a system is not life, nor does it transform a life. A system in and of itself is nothing. What Christianity has and the others do not have is life. In fact, the life of Jesus himself," end quote. This is the essence. He says in verse 2, the life appeared. He's talking about the incarnation. Jesus became man. And we have seen it. We've seen him. And we testify to it. And we proclaim to you the eternal life, nickname for Jesus, which was with the Father. That's where the Son of God was before the incarnation. He has appeared to us. My friends, Jesus is eternal life. Remember, eternal and everlasting are different. Everlasting is something that starts now and goes on forever. Eternal always has been and always will be. He always has been light. He always will be life. He is life now. He simply is life. He is true life. He is the real life. And this is the essential message of the Christian gospel. Libby and I went and saw the movie The Lion. Some of you might have seen it. Powerful movie. If you love India, you have to see it. It's the story of a little boy who gets separated by a long distance from his family. I mean, little, like 4 or 5 years old, and finds himself on the streets all alone in India. The first third of the movie is an amazing picture of what it's like to be 5 years old on the street alone in India. It's devastating. And he's rummaging through garbage to find food. And people are taking advantage of him, and it's really rough. And And through a course of events, he finds himself in an orphanage. So he's no longer just helpless and hopeless like he was on the street. Now he's helpless and hopeless surrounded by a bunch of other helpless and hopeless kids. And he's just sitting there waiting for whatever happens next. And what happens next is beautiful. He gets adopted by a family from Australia. Gets plucked into this family, very loving family. And they give him a life, they give him a home, and they give him clothes, and they give him food, and they give him education, and they have a yacht. I mean, he's out on the yacht. I mean, he went from the streets of India to living a life, right? But what was fascinating is even though they gave him a life, he was despondent inside. He was longing, he was struggling, he was discontent because he longed to know his family in India. There's a valuable lesson in this. You can have a life and not have the life. You can make a life for yourself and still have a bottomless pit of dissatisfaction. Be missing out on this complete satisfaction called joy. Augustine lived a life. Augustine was a really old church father hundreds and hundreds of years ago. Before he became a believer, he was a wealthy young man, living high on the hog. And he was despondent. He knew his life was full of sin. He knew he was separated from God. He just didn't know what to do about it. And so even though he had a life, he didn't have the life. And so one day he's reading in the book of Romans and he sees the truth and he bows his knee to Jesus Christ and he's converted. He's radically transformed. 10 years later, he sits down to start writing a memoir to God. It is been published. It's called Augustine's Confessions, one of the great literary pieces of all of history. But it's simply his journal to God. And at one point in this journal, he says this beautiful summary statement, and I quote, "You have made us for yourself, and our hearts are restless until they find rest in you. You, God, have made me for yourself. My heart will be restless until I find my rest in you." You were created for koinonia with the Father. And until you are experiencing koinonia with the Father, your hearts will not be at rest. No one's will. And the essence of the Christian life is the joy of sharing in the eternal life of Christ. Koinonia. Together, look at verse 3. "We proclaim to you what we have seen and heard so that you also may have koinonia with us." So we're not just having koinonia with the Father. The moment that we come into koinonia with the Father through the Son, we come into koinonia with our brothers and sisters in Christ as well. We are sharing in life together. Life in Christ is not intended to be lived in a vacuum, to be lived virtually, to be lived at a distance. It is a communal experience. If you're going to experience intimacy with Christ, if you're going to experience this steady satisfaction called joy, I'm here to tell you, it'll be done in the context of loving biblical community. It's where you'll experience it. So the essence of the Christian life is the joy of sharing in the eternal life of Christ together. John said it this way, and this is the testimony. God has given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. Whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son of God does not have life, period. So do you have him? Don't say it out loud. Do you have him? Some of you say, no, I don't. What are you waiting for? Seriously, what are you waiting for? You're like, well, I'm busy building a life. You can have a life and not have the life, and the life is where it's found. Don't wait another day. Bow your knee to him. Receive the gift he's offering you. He'll make you new. He'll make you totally new. And he'll come and live inside you, joining himself to you. This you can experience today. Do you have him? Some of you say, yes, but. Well, but what? But I still lack joy. I don't experience that intimacy. I'm struggling to love people. I lack assurance. I get easily pulled off center by false teaching. I'm struggling. Keep coming back. John in this letter is going to hit you right between the eyes with truth that will set you free. When we were in New York a couple of weeks ago, we were in Manhattan. I don't know if you've been in Manhattan lately or ever, but one thing I notice about Manhattan is there's lots of people there. Like, all over the place, people. You go in the subways, people. You walk along the streets, people. We went to the 9/11 memorial, people everywhere. We went to the theater district, people, people, people. You're gonna lose respect for me. We went to Times Square on New Year's Eve. Yeah. Don't ever do it. Oh, it was awful, absolutely awful. More people than can possibly be pushed into one little area, and then millions more came. That's my description of it. It was awful, awful. People, 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 people. You know what I notice about myself when I'm in crowds like that? I can see dead people. No, I see dead people. I see dead people walking around. You're in a crowd like that, you have the opportunity in about 5 minutes to look into the eyes of about 200 people, and you see death there. Death. Death, 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 death. Dead people walking around. We went to see Fiddler on the Roof. It's a great old story. It was really special for us to see it because J.C. Schuster, who is a young man who grew up here at Bent Tree, incredible artist, amazing dancer. We always used to say to him, "You should be on Broadway." Well, he's on Broadway. He's in the Fiddler on the Roof cast, right? And he's like one of their main dancers. And so we got to see JC dancing. It was just so much fun. And afterwards, he invited us backstage. And you know what I noticed when we got back to stage? I didn't notice all the cool stuff backstage. You know what I noticed? I noticed the life in that young man. It just jumped out at me. You looked in his eyes and they were dancing with life. You listened to his words and they were full of love. There was light in him. You know what's different about him? He has Jesus. It's different. What's different between us and people who are far from God is we have the life and they don't. It's the essence. It is the core when everything else evaporates. Please pray with me. Lord Jesus, thank you for this letter. Thank you for the truth. Thank you for the joy we're going to experience in diving into it. Thank you for how you're going to minister to our silent struggles. Oh, Jesus, have your way with us, I pray. And I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.